गुड मॉर्निंग.
माय टॉपिक फॉर टुडे इज आईसीयू मैनेजमेंट प्रोटोकॉल इन कोविड-19. सो अराउंड 14% ऑफ पेशेंट्स नीड एडमिशन फॉर मोर सिवियर डिजीज नीडिंग ऑक्सीजन थेरेपी एंड मोस्टली इट इज इन द सेकेंड वीक एंड इंक्रीज सोफा स्कोर इंक्रीज डी डाइमर एंड elderly patients with more comorbidities have poor diagnosis. And out of these, 5% will need ICU admission. Most common complication is of respiratory system. So a bit about the prevention of infection among critical care professionals, which is of great importance. So it is mostly during aerosol generation procedures. So we need to be in fit tested N95 mask, gloves, gown, face and eye protection, and closed circuit suctioning, which reduces exposure to aerosols in intubated patients. As much as possible, we should try to limit the procedures, and we should avoid as much as possible. Only when needed, we should go for non-invasive mechanical ventilation. So ideal, what is ideal COVID ICU? So which is segregated from one patient care areas. It should have a separate entry and exit, a dedicated lift and a guarded staircase. Single cubicles with spatial separation should be there. And spacing between the beds should be at least 1 to 2 meters. And the total ICU area should be 3 times total space of the beds. And the main issues which needs to be taken care is of aerosol generating procedure because of high viral load, and we need to maintain our negative pressure. So ideally, HEPA filters should be installed in the ICU, and the air changes at least 6 times. The air changes should be there, with at least 2 times fresh air change should be there. So the procedures which are aerosol generating are bronchoscopy and upper GI endoscopy when doing CPR, NIV, endotracheal intubation, extubation, mask ventilation when we do sputum induction, physiotherapy, nebulizer therapy, suctioning. So we are going to see about some of these procedures, how it changes in COVID era. So the intubation technique which we should be ideally doing is the rapid sequence induction. Before that, we should give meticulous pre-oxygenation with 100% O2 for 3 to 5 minutes. Use of well-fitted mask is again and again emphasized with a closed circuit or rebreathing circuit. And a high-efficiency hydrophobic filter should be placed between the face mask and the veins circuit, or between face mask and the bag. And full-time monitoring should be there with waveform capnography. Intubation plan, we should give hypnotic agents like propofol or ketamine. A neuromuscular blockade should be given, succinylcholine or rocuronium, to minimize apnea time and the risk of patient coughing. And availability of vasopressor for bolus or infusion should be used. So this is according to the Surviving Sepsis Campaign COVID-19 by the European Society. Use of paralytics. So neuromuscular blocking agent, ideally it should be given, intermittent boluses should be given on need basis. That is by Surviving Sepsis Campaign, it is weak recommendation, low quality evidence. Continuous neuromuscular blocking agent up to 48 hours should be given only when there is a persistent ventilator dysynchrony and the need for ongoing deep sedation, or the need for prone ventilation, or persistently high plateau pressures. So a bit about face mask ventilation, ideally should be avoided, but if there is a need for rescue face mask ventilation, then both the hands, some instructions that the both the hands should be used. 2-person technique should be used, and early use of oropharyngeal airway. Assistant should be having the bag, and low flows of 3 to 4 liter per minute should be used with low tidal volume. So ideally, video laryngoscope should be used. And for confirming the correct depth of insertion, we should not do auscultation, but just eyeballing for equal bilateral chest wall expansion. And in case of doubt, we should use a ultrasound. So airway interventions which require disconnection of ventilator are when we administer neuromuscular blocking agent. To stop gas flows, we should disconnect from the ventilator to avoid the aerosol generation. And in case we need to clamp the tracheal tube, we need to disconnect from the ventilator. To separate the circuit with high, this is the filter, heat and moist filter. When it is still attached to the patient, we should disconnect the ventilator to avoid aerosol generation. And to reverse this process, after reconnection, we should disconnect the ventilator. Nebulization therapy in ICU setting, if the patient is spontaneously breathing, always we should use the MDI with pacer. And during in ventilated patient, we should use a vibrating mesh nebulizer, and the additional filter should be placed at the expiratory port of ventilation. So between oxygen delivery through high flow nasal cannula and NIV, the advantages of HFNC is we can use a tight fitted mask above the cannula to contain the aerosols. So when we are using NIV, we should use a well fitted mask, if possible a helmet, and we should avoid the use of nasal mask or nasal pillows whenever possible. And if it is a dual limb ventilator, we have to use a filter should be placed at the ventilator outlets. And if it is a single limb non-invasive ventilator, at the expiratory ports, filter should be present. So a bit about the critical care admission criteria. So in case of severe pneumonia with ARDS, when the respiratory rate is more than 30 per minute, in case of severe respiratory distress, when the saturation is less than 93% at room air, or the chest X-ray which shows lung involvement of more than 50% in 1 to 2 hours, so 1 to 2 days. So all cases of ARDS and the critical cases like with respiratory failure, septic shock, or multiple organ dysfunction require critical care admission. So a bit about what is more important in monitoring. TEF ratio versus saturation. So it is said that saturation is more important. So the usual TEF ratio is less useful than clinical performance and close monitoring of the saturation. So a saturation, a drop in saturation less than 93% despite oxygen therapy, it helps to predict rapid disease progression. And because of this, rapid de-escalation of therapy is not advised because of the risk. There is always a risk of deterioration. So a bit about stepwise management of acute respiratory failure and early ARDS. So immediately once the patient is admitted, we should obtain a swab for testing, ideally nasal or oropharyngeal swab. And if two or more samples are negative, then we should consider bronchoscopy, and as much as possible, we should avoid doing bronchoscopy because it is an aerosol generating procedure. Then we have to monitor the oxygenation and work of breathing. So if the patient is stable, we can continue oxygenation via nasal cannula. The saturation maintained should be between 90 to 96, and we should avoid saturation less than 90% and the saturation of more than 96%. On worsening, first step will be high flow nasal cannula and second step will be NIV management. So ventilator strategy we have already seen before. So low tidal volume strategy and to maintain a peep of more than 10 centimeter higher peep with allowing hypercapnia prone ventilation for 12 to 16 hours. And if there is severe hypoxia, we can even opt for nitric acid inhalation. effect of prone position. This was published in NEJM in 2013 in ARDS. So here, during a prone position, here we can see the cumulative probability of survival is more. So this is focused only in case of moderate to severe ARDS. So ECMO, we have to start. We need to give rest to the lungs and provide a bridge while lung recovery. So there is also cardiac related failure which we see in COVID due to myocarditis and myocardial infarction or sepsis related myocardiopathy. So here we should give ultra protective mechanical ventilation, plateau pressure of less than 24, deep of around 10, and maintain a respiratory rate of 10 to 30 per minute. So this is a summary of treatment in severe ARDS related to coronavirus. So previously we have seen in different presentations. So this is published in Lancet. So here, as seen, high flow nasal oxygen will prevent or delay the need for intubation. And here prone positioning in case of worsening hypoxemia is indicated. Glucocorticoids, role of glucocorticoids is not recommended till now. But in a lot of studies from China, they have given glucocorticoids. A bit about sepsis and septic shock in ICU patients. So this happens in 5% of the patients who are admitted in ICU. Case fatality is 50%, and it is because of dysregulated host response to infection. So crystalloids are preferred over colloids, and vasoactive agents, norepinephrine is preferred over dopamine, and dobutamine should be added if there is cardiac dysfunction. And there is a role of low-dose corticosteroid therapy here for shock reversal over no corticosteroid therapy. This is weak recommendation published in Surviving Sepsis Campaign. And hydrocortisone 200 mg per day is administered either as an infusion or intermittent doses. So there can be infectious diseases. So during this time, we need to remember the usual community infections and the pathologies in addition to hospital acquired infection. And empirical antibiotics should be started within 1 hour based on the clinical diagnosis and local epidemiology. A bit about cytokine storm syndrome. So this leads to poor prognosis. Mostly it happens in the second week of hospital stay. And the markers which are seen are interleukin-2, interleukin-6, 7, and TNF-alpha. Cardiovascular diseases are due to myocardial injury, can be because of cytokine storm or direct myocardial injury. So high markers which are elevated are troponin, and ECG changes will be there, and leads to 40% of causes of death due to myocarditis. A bit about hematological changes which we see in a stable patient, there will be leukopenia and some bone marrow suppression. In severe disease, the mortality is around 13 times higher. And what we see is secondary hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, which includes criteria of leukopenia, hemoglobin of less than 9.2 grams per deciliter, and platelet, low platelets. Either one may be there or all of these criteria may be present. So at present, there are some immunosuppressive treatment like tatlizumab and genus kinase inhibition for treating cytokine storm by controlling viral entry. And steroids also can be given. But WHO has recommended against the use of steroids because of concerns of increased viral shedding. But in Chinese studies, they have given methylprednisolone to suppress the inflammatory reaction. Other disorders which we can see are system involvement of acute renal failure, liver involvement can be seen. And these patients require early enteral feeding should be started in the ICU patients. Other standard of care should be given, and early mobilization should be emphasized. So when to discharge a COVID-19 positive patient is when there is significant resolution of symptoms, when there is radiological clearance, and documented virological clearance in at least two samples more than 24 hours apart. And even after discharge, they should be advised for a home quarantine for at least 2 weeks. Because in view of recent reports emerging from China regarding persistence of virus in respiratory secretions in spite of adequate treatment. And there should be a warning of possibility of reinfection of COVID-19 should also be given to them. So in our ICU, we are following these general protocols. So prone positioning in our ICU, we are every 8 hours, we are changing the position. First, we are starting with prone. Then we are going to left lateral recumbent. Then sitting position also is advised 30 to 90 degrees, followed by right lateral. So every 8 hours, they are shifting the position of the patient.